We'd like to wish you a happy Sabbath and seasonal greetings. Welcome to the GCA Church's Festival of Carols. Some of the world's most beautiful music surrounds this season of worship and praise to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who came to earth as a baby born in a stable.
If you'd like to continue listening to some of this wonderful music we're going to enjoy this morning, this afternoon, Camerata will be performing their concert in the foyer of the church, and it's beautiful acoustics, and I know you're really going to enjoy that. If you'd like some things to do for this week, we have a couple things that you can choose from. One is Cobalt Elementary Annual Christmas Program. The eighth grade is trying to raise money for their class trip, and they will be serving a meal and have goodies at 6 o'clock. On this Wednesday, December 14, the program will begin at 7 p.m. Also, if you would like to join the community and GCA Church in caroling, which is a very fun event, we go to some homes who we're going to join the campus ministries of GCA and meet in the parking lot of the school at 7 p.m. We're going to go caroling, and we're also going to take cookies to them, help bring some joy. And so I hope a lot of you ladies will bake up a batch and contact Kaylee Kelch. That's this Wednesday, December 14th. This is going to be the same night as the Copal program. But anyway, I hope a lot of you will be able to go caroling. We did it last year, and it's a very rewarding experience, and the people there really enjoy having us come sing and bring them cookies. So that's December 14th at 7.
There are some other announcements in this little short white piece of paper that you got with your red bulletin for the morning program, and I would refer the church members to those announcements that are in that additional news note. At this time, we will begin our worship service, and Pastor Hudson will lead us in the opening hymn.
Good morning. Let's stand together and sing hymn number 132, O Come All Ye Faithful. This is a perfect song for this time of year as we gather as the faithful in the church. Number 132, O Come All Ye Faithful.
Joyful and triumphant, O Good morning. The offering this week is for Adventist Community Services. Psalm 9:18 says, "But God will never forget the needy. The hope of the afflicted will never perish." It is a season of giving. It is a season to acknowledge the needs around us. When God talks about the needy, I don't think he's usually referencing, "I need an iPhone 7, because my iPhone 6 isn't running as fast as it used to." I think he's usually thinking of really cold mornings like this morning, and people who truly don't have food in the cupboards, or heat in their homes, or a home. We are privileged to be in our situations that we're in. We have a lot to be proud of in our denomination. Adventist Community Services does an enormous amount of good, but they do this enormous amount of good through the resources that we provide. So if God is never going to forget the needy, and we are to be the hands of God, if we are to do God's work, then it is up to us to also never forget the needy. Would the deacons please stand? Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for Christmas, for the beautiful season that it is. Thank you for all that you have given us. And God, help us, inspire us, convict us to be generous, to see the needs around us, and to respond with our time and our money, whatever we have. Help us not to be selfish and to put others first. Thank you again for all you do for us. Amen.
Children, and happy Sabbath. This is a special time for you guys in the main room. You guys can come up to the front and have a story. And on your way up to the front, see if anybody has some dollar bills or $10 or $100 bills hanging out there for you to bring up to our little church this morning.
Thank you. What a treat to have so many kids with us this morning. Well, good morning, everybody. Well, I'm figuring you guys kind of know what time of year this is. That one person knows. Christmas! Who's decorated the tree? Who's put lights out? That is right. Well, guys, I'm going to tell you a Christmas story today and about the best gift I have ever got. And it starts when I was a little bit older than you guys. I was actually 15 years old. Now, the thing about this awesome, amazing gift is that it doesn't matter if you are 3, if you are 7, 10, 15, 30, 50, when you fall in love with that new bike, that bicycle that shines and those wheels that are so smooth as they go around, you can be any age you want. Because they are the best gift ever. And it was this Christmas, as I walked past the window and I saw that bike, I said to my mum and dad, I have to have this bicycle. Oh, Mum, you know, it takes me forever to bike to school. My friends all get to school way earlier than me, and then they get home way earlier than me. But, Mum, hey, just think, if you got me this new, not only a bicycle, it was a 10-speed bicycle. I could be home so quick, I could help you out with all those jobs around the house that you're always wanting me to help you with. Oh, I knew how to work my mum. Yeah. Well, you know what? Christmas came. I was so excited. I woke up that morning and I jumped out of bed. But there's a couple of things that happen at our place on Christmas. We have a huge family. Such a big family that do you think we can get up and open the presents straight away? Mm-mm. Because we have extended family that live like an hour away, and they have their breakfast first, and then they drive to our house, and then we all sit around, there's about 30 of us, and we open presents together. Can you imagine how long you have to wait to open your presents? But my parents, they kind of knew how excited me and my brother were, and they said, this Christmas morning you can open one present. One present. Okay, well, I know what I'm going to open. If it's there, my fingers were crossed and I jumped out of bed and I ran out there and there was the Christmas tree. And what do you think was under the tree? A 10-speed shiny bike that had my name written on it. I had got the best gift you could ever be given. I was so excited. I jumped on that bike and I rode up and down my driveway. Must have been 100 times. And then I knew that my cousins were going to call and they were going to be here any minute, so I couldn't go further down the road. And I waited. I went in and I had breakfast. I went back out and I rode that bike up and down that driveway again. And then I came back and the phone rang. And it was my cousins and they said, hey, we're running just a little bit late. So we'll be there in 40 minutes. 40 minutes? I can do so much in 40 minutes on a 10-speed bike. Do you know how fast I can go? So I went out and I said, Mom, Dad, can I go down the road? And they were like, sure, Kim, you got 40 minutes. Keep an eye on your watch. So I jump on my bike and I ran over to where my dog was tied. He was a black Labrador and his name was Mac. If any of you know, I have another black dog now named Mac, named after him. And I let him off, and he was getting a little old, so, you know, I couldn't go really fast, but I didn't care, because I had those low gears that make you go really fast, but you don't really go anywhere, and then I had those really high gear that you pedal really hard, but you're going so slow, you don't go fast, so it was okay, and Mac was running along beside me, and we went up our driveway, we went down the road past our neighbor's house, and the neighbors had a dog that was on a chain, and every time you went past it, it would go, oh, I was like, okay. So I always went on the other side of the road, biked really fast, and Mac would run along beside me. And then there's my best friend's granddad's house on this side. And he was underneath his car doing some mechanical thing, and I said, Merry Christmas, Granddad! And he waved, and on I kept going. And then the other neighbor, they had a goat farm, and then there was actually a rabbit farm, believe it or not, as well, on the next place. And then a little further on down was my best friend Kaylee's house, and she had horses. And so I biked all the way down there, and Mac was just running along beside me, happy as can be. And I thought, you know, I should probably turn around. And I turned around, and I went back past my friend's place, back past the rabbit, past the goat, past my her granddad's place, and then past the dog. And that dog ran out at the chain again. And went, but this time, the chain broke. And when that chain broke, that dog didn't stop like he usually stops on the end. And he kept going straight for my dog, Mac. Two things you need to know about this. My dad always said to me, do not get in the middle of a dog fight. Because the dog sometimes gets a little bit crazy and they don't know what they're doing. And you might get bitten. Don't get in the middle of a dog fight. And I remember this. And then the other thing, and I learned this a little later on, with dogs, and these two dogs were the same size, when they fight, dogs make a lot of noise. A lot of grumbling and growling and biting and barking. And usually, it's all noise. There's not usually too much damage. You know, they might get a little punch a wound, but it's not usually very bad. But I didn't know that this time. And when this dog came and attacked my Mac, I stood back and I yelled, stop it, stop it. I didn't know what else to do because I wasn't allowed to get in the middle of that. And they kept going. And then I started to see this other dog. He was starting to get the better of my dog. And he had him kind of pinned on the ground. And I was like, oh, I don't know what to do. So I started yelling, help, help, somebody help my dog, help, help. And the next thing I knew, at the corner of my eye, I have never seen my dad run so fast across the pasture. He leapt that fence in one bound and he came running to those dogs. Now, right as he was running for those dogs, before I saw him, I had done something I shouldn't have done. I had got in there and I started to hit the other dog on the head, trying to break up the dog fight. Stop it! Help somebody! Stop it! As I'm hitting him, and then nothing. They didn't even know I was there. I was like a fly on them. But the second they saw my dad running at them, they split as quick as can be. And that other dog ran behind his house. And my dog, Mac, took off like a shot to our house. And my dad came straight for me and he said, Kim, are you okay? And I was shaking. I was so upset. I'd been like really scared. And I said, yeah, I'm okay, Dad, I'm okay. And he says, all right, well, I'm going to go check Mac's okay. And he said, and you just come on home. Because he knew I had my best gift ever, the bike. Well, I pick up that best gift ever, and I was a little shaky, so I thought, I'm just going to walk it home. It's real close. And as I'm walking down the road, and I turn in our drive, and as I'm walking down the driveway, I look down, and I notice something's on my leg. And I look down, and it's blood. And what had happened is when I had got in the middle of something I shouldn't have, I had got bitten by one of the dogs. And I had a huge bite mark that I still have today right around my leg. You see, I was so lucky to have a dad that when I yelled help, even when I got in the middle of a dog fight that I shouldn't have been in the middle of, when I yelled help, he heard me and he came and saved me. And that is the Christmas story to me. When I am hurting so much, I am in so much pain and I'm yelling out help to my Lord, I'm like, God, help me, I don't know where to go, I'm lost. Lord, help me choose what to do. God looks down at me and he says, Kim, I have got the best gift for you. He says, Charlotte. He says, Jaden, Vanessa, I have got the best gift in the world for you. And you know how he sent him? In a little cradle, swaddled in cloth, in a manger, surrounded with all these barn animals. And the Lord said, because I love you and you cried out help, I'm going to give you the best gift you are ever going to receive. And that is Jesus Christ. And you know the most wonderful thing about this Christmas gift? We don't just get it on Christmas. We get it every single day that we say, Jesus, I love you and I choose you. And that is the best kind of gift. It is so much better than a 10-speed bike. It's better than any package you're going to ever receive under that Christmas tree. It is the gift of Jesus Christ. Let's just pray real quick. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank you so much for the best gift you have ever given and that we will ever receive, and that is your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you for loving us. We love you too.
As all the children are finding their way back to the seats, I wanted to invite everyone here to see if they can slide to the middle as much as possible. We have a full house, and there are people who join us, you know, into the program at some point, and we'd like to make sure that they have a place that they can sit when they enter. Happy Sabbath, Merry Christmas! Wonderful time for all of us to be here together as one big family, and I'm so glad to see everybody here. I'm so thankful for the music that we're about to enjoy together today on the Sabbath. It's time now for our morning prayer, and you know, as a teacher, and as we're in our classes, as all of us meet together, oftentimes at the beginning of each class we ask for prayer requests, and we go through the typical spectrum of requests that we might hear, but typically the most meaningful ones, which aren't not the ones necessarily said out loud, but the ones when you see a student or two raise their hand for a silent request, you know that something is going on that's challenging them, and they're working through something, whether it's something back home or something in their own hearts, not something they want to just share out loud with their classmates, but something that's going on. And I know that, you know, back home, and we're praying for our kids. You know, we don't know what those silent requests are with so many of them, and I know that that God hears and knows every one of those requests, and I'm so thankful for that. For our prayer this morning, as the congregation is going to kneel together, what I'd like to do is I'd like to invite anybody here with requests like those, like those silent requests, things that you have going on in your heart, things that are going on back at home. Whatever those things may be, maybe they're praises, maybe God's working miracles in your family right now during this season that we have, you know, Thanksgiving, Christmas stretch. We have so much to be thankful for. Maybe there's something like that that's going on, and you'd like to bring that forward here. I'd like to invite anybody who has a burden, anybody who has a struggle that they would like to give to God right now, that you would come forward and pray with me. We have microphones up here in the front, so if you would, if we could have some people, you know, kneel on the sides and kind of press in as much as we can around each other, I want to invite you guys to come forward and kneel with me in prayer, or you may kneel where you are at this moment. So we're going to give you guys a moment to consider that. We have several people that we are going to be praying for. We think about the Blivens here in our own GCA family, and for those that would like to lift them up in prayer, I would invite you to come forward and join me as we pray for them. Think about the Marshall family, as they've lost Rick Marshall, and I know some of you guys who were students of his, and we want to pray for that family, and especially for the students who have been impacted by his loss. So we'll take a moment here, and if you would like to join me up in front, we'll do that now, and then everyone else will kneel where we are.
Let's all kneel for prayer. Our Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the God that you are. We thank you for your love, your mercy, and your grace. And even when we so often don't recognize you and who you are, you continue to be the awesome God that you are. We thank you and we praise you for that. We have so many things to be thankful for in this season as we reflect on the blessings that you've given to us, the things that you've placed in our lives, not just the material things, even though those are important, the houses, the roofs over our head, the food at our table, but the blessings that you've provided for us, the family members that you've placed into our lives, the just the countless things that we can reflect on and those that we just don't know about. We thank you for those. And Lord, we want to lift up to you things that are struggling for us, the things that are weighing heavily in our hearts, the sins that are distractions in our lives. We ask for your forgiveness for those. Lord, a lot of times we struggle with things in our lives that we may not even be willing to let go of. And Lord, even with those, we can ask you for a change of our heart, for a way for us to be willing to let go of those sins, those things that are getting in the way of our relationship with you. Lord, we come before you with some requests and some things that are weighing us down, especially in this time of thankfulness and Christmas, and we're mourning the losses of family members and close ones. We think about Rick Marshall, and we think about the impact that he had on so many people. We thank you for his ministry and the way that he worked with so many young people in his school and the family members that are here that are mourning the loss. We think about also the Darville family as they're mourning the loss as well. We lift them up and ask that you'll just draw close to them. We think about those who are struggling through illness. Lord, we try what we can here on this earth, but you are the ultimate healer, and we're thankful for the way that you can work miracles. We lift up the Blivens and then their struggle with cancer, and I just pray that as a church family, we'll be able to be close to them and encourage them and pray for them, and Lord, I just know that you can work miracles, and we ask for your will to be done, but at the same time, we're thankful that you're a God that is bigger than cancer, is bigger than illness, whatever it might be. And we also think of Jean Jewell as well. Thank you so much for just being a part of this process as we are struggling with whatever it might be. And I know I'll also think about other family members that are represented here. There are illnesses and sicknesses and struggles back home. We lift those up to you as well. And Lord, as we celebrate this Christmas season, help us to remember the true reason. We thank you for sending Jesus to this earth. We thank you for the sacrifice and the gift that he represents. Help us not to get caught up too much in the secularism, the commercialism of Christmas, and focus on the sacred. We thank you so much for this program, the music that we're about to enjoy. I just can't wait until we can enjoy the choirs and the music in heaven. Lord, may the words of our mouths and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. Amen.
Thank you. Then Isaiah said,
"Hear ye now, O house of David. Is it a small thing for you to weary men? But will ye weary my God also? Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel."
The people that have walked in darkness have seen a great light. They that dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them that light shined.
The people who walk in darkness have seen a great light. The people who walk in darkness have seen a great light. Now lift up your eyes, see the glory of the Lord. Now lift up your eyes, see the glory of the Lord. And the flesh will see it together. The people who walk in darkness have seen a great light.
Angel Gabriel was sent from God unto the city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin espoused to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David, and the virgin's name was Mary. And the angel came in unto her and said,
"Hail, thou that art highly favored, the Lord is with thee, blessed art thou among women."
And when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying, and cast in her mind what manner of salutation this should be. And the angel said unto her,
"Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, and bring forth a son, and shalt call his name Jesus. He shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David, and he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end." Then Mary said unto the angel,
"How shall this be, seeing I know not a man?" And the angel said unto her,
"The Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. And behold, thy cousin Elizabeth, she hath also conceived a son in her old age. And this is the sixth month with her who was called barren.
For with God nothing shall be impossible."
And Mary said,
"Behold, the handmaid of the Lord, be it unto me according to thy word.
And the angel departed from her.
Now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise. When his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privily. But while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying,
Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, everyone into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee out of the city of Nazareth into Judea unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn.
And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them,
Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger.
And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying,
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men.
And it came to pass, as the angels were gone from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another,
Let us now go even unto Bethlehem and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us.
And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And when they had said it, they made known abroad, saying, which was told them concerning the child. And all that they heard, it wondered at those things which they were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, and it was told unto them.
Thank you.
Now, when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, there came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying,
"Where is he that is born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and are come to worship him."
When Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. And they said unto him,
"In Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, 'And thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judea, art not the least among the princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel.'"
Then Herod, when he had privily called the wise men, inquired of them diligently what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said,
"Go and search diligently for the young child. And when you have found him, bring me word again, that I may come and worship him also."
When they heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and the same man was just and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Ghost was upon him. And it was revealed to him by the Holy Ghost that he should not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came by the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought the child Jesus to do for him after the custom of the law, he took him up in his arms and blessed God and said,
"Lord, now lettest thy servant depart in peace according to thy word. For mine eyes have seen thy salvation, which thou hast prepared before the face of all people, a light to lighten the Gentiles and the glory of thy people Israel.
And Joseph and his mother marveled at those things which were spoken of him.
Thank you.
Thank you to all the musicians and directors and everyone else who participated. In Galatians 4, it says, "But when the fullness of the time had come, God sent forth his Son to redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive adoption as sons and daughters." And so Jesus was born in Bethlehem, but that's not the end of the story, because Jesus lived and ministered and died for our sins. But that's not the end of the story, because Jesus rose again and said, "I am going to prepare a place for you, and if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to be with me." But that's not the end of the story. In the last paragraph of the last page of the last chapter of the book Great Controversy, it says, "The great controversy is ended. Sin and sinners are no more. The entire universe is clean. One pulse of humanity and gladness beats through the vast creation. From him who created all flow life and light and gladness throughout the realms of space. From the minutest atom to the greatest world, all things, animate and inanimate, in their unshadowed beauty and perfect joy, declare that God is love." And that's not the end of the story, but that's the beginning of the ongoing, eternal story that we will enjoy for all time. Let's bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for sending your Son to this world. Thank you for becoming Emmanuel, God with us. And we recognize that your great desire is to be with us for all eternity. And thank you that Jesus died for my sins and for the sins of each one of us here. And thank you for that promise of a soon return. In your name we pray. Amen.